this video, we're going to cover the revenue, and that's going to be on a per year basis. The slide for that is going to be the same one as the first video. Just copy pasted it for a little bit of sort of context. Equity per share, which for a company like this is extremely important, because if you guys go and look at the other companies in the shipping industry, you'll see that it's a similar story in terms of they're fairly discounted based off of their book value, but not all of them make money. Completely separate video is going to be one that's going to be put out talking about Castor Maritime and its competitors, but for this one we're just going to be covering Castor Maritime's equity per share value, and then at the very end we're going to be highlighting my personal portfolio. So again, this was a graph I put out with my first video a couple of months back. This is just the yearly revenues from 2017 up until present, so 21st of June 2023. So it's had about 6 years now, and you can see that it's skyrocketed. Now, one of the things that you guys are probably going to call me out on is, oh, well, the Toro spinoff and this, that, and the other. We're just looking sort of at the general. Obviously, the Toro spinoff brought in a lot of revenue. However, you're going to see that it still really didn't dampen the quarterly results, which I think is really interesting, because Petros in the quarterly report, if you go through and read it, will say that it was fairly seasonal. So there was less revenue than he expected, but overall we did pretty well for that quarter. This image here, guys, this slide is the newest quarterly report. Again, this is the revenue off the consolidated financial reports. And on the left column, you're going to see the first 3 months for 2022. And then on the right, you're going to see the first 3 months results for 2023. For the first quarter of 2022, the company made 16 million, almost 17. But then this year's first quarter, we actually did 23.3 million. So a substantial leap, which I think is pretty interesting. We did less in terms of revenue expenses, which is exactly what you want. Again, this particular industry is one that is incredibly expensive in terms of voyage expenses, because after each voyage, you need to do a lot of maintenance on these ships. And of course, if you know anything about the value of these ships, they depreciate very quickly in value. But the really great thing, if you look right under total expenses, you're going to see the operating income for 2023 for the first quarter was actually $17 million. So almost 17 and a half, if you want to, you know, be generous. But that is compared to its current market cap, which is like $39 million. So it's just a ludicrous amount of money that the company is making. And then if you go down there to other expenses right under that, you're going to see that a few more thousands of dollars in expenses. And then right under that, if you go to net income and comprehensive income from discontinued operations before taxes, you'll see that essentially our operating income increased. So we actually did make 17.5 mil. And then if you go to the very bottom row, so we have net income, net of taxes, meaning that the income tax has already been taken away. The sort of net profit was $17.3 million. This particular slide that I'm showing you guys is sort of a more comprehensive version of the one I just showed you. Really at the top, I just wanted to highlight the $10.8 million of net income, which again is just an obscene amount of money. So if we go down to the very, very bottom, right above where it says earnings slash parentheses loss per share, right above that is going to be net and comprehensive income. So for 2023 is actually $10.8 million. If you compare it to last year's figure, it's almost 50% less, because the previous year, again, we did $19 million. But the big thing, again, was that spinoff of the Toro, the dry ship, the dry bulk, whatever, it was a handful of vessels. But again, even all of that aside, the company still made an obscene amount of money net, which I think is pretty cool. And then at the bottom, you can see just the number of shares outstanding. It's about 94, 95 million, right around there. So to summarize, we did roughly 23 million in revenue, 17 million in operating income, which again, operating income is the money the management itself brings you. Net income is the total at the actual income after everything has been taken away, and you're left with the money that you actually make, so 10.8 million. The shares outstanding, again, 94 million thereabouts. But the really important thing that you guys need to see is going to be equity, and that is going to be $434 million, roughly thereabouts. And again, equity is the total value of the assets. So you take the assets, you subtract all of the liabilities, what you're left with is equity. Some people might also call them net assets. But if you see here, once you do the equation for it, which is literally you take the equity, which is $434 million, divided by the shares outstanding, which is 94 million, which is this figure up here, you get $4.59. And we're going to go ahead and compare that to the current not only stock price, but market cap. So we can see here the current market cap as of today, the day I'm recording, which is the 21st of June, 2023, the market cap is $39.2 million. And the current stock price is 41 cents, which, is one of those really interesting opportunities because you could look at the stock price and say, oh, yeah, it's a penny stock, whatever. But it's not sort of just a penny stock. I mean, this is a company that is extremely undervalued based off of its actual numbers. I mean, these numbers aren't lying. It made $10 million in profit. The company itself, on paper, its book value is 10 times what its current market cap is. And I think that for me is market irrationality at its finest. So, like I said, I actually fudged up this number right here. This was off of the market cap, this 39.63 million. That was off of the 11th of June. I actually held off about 10 days making this. Honestly, I was just pretty lazy. I didn't really want to do the video. I was downloaded a bunch of games on my Switch and I've been playing Devil May Cry and Phoenix Wright. But the current market cap is going to be $400,000 less. So equity divided by market cap again is going to be that $434 million divided by the market cap, which is if you wanted to buy the whole business, what you could buy it for, which on the open market would be 41 cents a share. There are 94 million shares outstanding, so that's how we're getting that $39 million market cap. And if you divide that, you actually find out that your investment, if somebody came in and swooped up the entire thing and gave you your full value, meaning if somebody comes in, pays, let's say, $40 million, right? And then they purchase all of your shares at the value of 434 million, so your $4.59, you would be 11xing your investment, which to me is just absolutely ludicrous because it's like, the price just keeps going down. So obviously for me, I'm like, okay, this is great. I like the business. Let's buy more of it. And that's exactly what I've been doing. So on this sheet here, I just wanted to highlight my personal portfolio, and we're going to be, as you guys can see, I own four securities, so Castor Maritime being about 89% of my portfolio, and then a little bit of Amcon, which is a really phenomenal distribution company that I really like, and then a couple of shares of Lucid, really just so I can get a good sense of where they're at, and then Nintendo because I figured I've been playing Nintendo games since I was a kid. There is a pretty good chance that the stock's going to be here forever. So I'm going to be increasing my stake in Nintendo when I'm very much a richer person. But what I wanted to highlight was these two figures right up here. So I own about 70,500 shares of Castor Maritime, which is a little under 1% of the entire business. And I did this because, again, love the business. I think it's great. I think the money's going to be there. I think over the next 5, 10 years, some whale is going to come along and buy out the entire business. But yeah, this is my entire portfolio. You guys can see that I bought 36,000 shares thereabouts for about $1 a share. And you guys can see this particular purchase was a wash sale because about 2 years ago I discovered the stock when it was trading at about $1.60 and was buying and selling and going in and out of that particular trade. And then about a year ago, I was like, I actually kind of really like this business. So started buying up as much of it as I could. And then this is actually the most recent purchase. So the second line right here, where I bought 34,000 shares at around 47 cents. This was a couple of weeks back. And so I liquidated my TQQQ position and ended up buying just Castor Maritime because the upside for Castor Maritime is much greater than that NASDAQ. The leverage NASDAQ ETF, that TQQQ. So for me, Castor is what I'm going to hold just because the upside is way, it's much greater than owning something that is volatile, yeah, but like for me, I know I can probably outperform that over the course of my lifetime. So that's why I own as many shares of Castor as I do. Love the management, even though it's just the one guy. And yeah, so looking forward to seeing what you guys think. I think that the company is gonna do great. Hopefully somebody comes in and buys it out. But other than that, yeah, look forward to hearing what you guys think.